For everybody who doesn't know, this is Christoph Dorbeck. Christoph does our Linux presentations once a year. He says he works for Red Hat. He gets paid by Red Hat. Work, I don't know. And we also have a guest speaker, Dan Walsh. And Christoph will introduce Dan. Actually, Dan spoke here about 10 years ago. When he had a little bit more hair, too.
Yeah.
Didn't he?
No. No. Do you have like a little bit of long hair and rock fire?
All right. Okay.
Good.
All right, lights are okay. Should we turn them down?
I think my screen's fine from here.
I'm not being asked to turn them down a little bit. They wash out the screen a little bit. These don't have.
It's not that bad. And, When he turned it, when he make it dark like you did before, the video looks like crap when it goes up to YouTube.
Well, let's see. Can you use this?
That's way too soft.
Okay. No.
That's better.
That's what it was.
Stop in between.
You can't stop it in between where you had as many of them, like you hit on the middle buttons. That's
interesting. Yeah, here's one.
That's
too
dark.
These are discrete buttons, they're not slider switches like we have in the other one.
Take a hoodie and throw them over a one or two lamps.
That's not dangerous.
Far from it, no. All right. Welcome. Thank you for having me on again. Quick survey. Who's familiar with traditional virtualization like VMware or KVM? Who's using KVM today?
I got to switch between my monitor and my keyboard.
Has anybody played with Linux container technology? A little bit of that. All right. So I'm due to present on this type of material in a couple of weeks at the Red Hat Summit, so you kind of get a preview of some of the slide work that I'm working on. A lot of it's rough, but. Let's discuss containers. Okay, so Fedora users, run Ubuntu, CentOS, other?
Red Hat.
Red Hat? Are you using Red Hat on your portable laptop?
No, no, wait. Yes, that works.
Okay. Does anybody else here work for Red Hat besides me? Do you have any spies in the crowd? Alright. I can't talk about release dates or anything like that related to RHEL 7. There's still a lot of stuff that's in flux. Obviously, anything that's upstream, like things that are being developed in Fedora, we can talk about. That's what we're going to be sharing here today. One of the key things in RHEL 7, or now in Fedora, when did containers show up in Fedora? Is that 1819? When LXC kind of, you know? Doesn't matter.
Sorry.
So.
I would argue that containers have been around since RHEL 5,
but it's
an annual basis. But Liberate LXC showed up probably in Fedora 8.
And that was, Liberate.c also showed up in RHEL 6 as a type preview, I think in 6.3 or 6.4. Okay. So among the other things in RHEL 7 that's of significant interest, containers is probably the one technology that's creating a lot of market buzz. And that's because it enables another type of virtualization. So virtualization is called containers. They've been referred to as application containers, and some people refer to it as Docker containers. Docker is a particular technology that implements all kinds of parts of the Linux kernel, Linux operating system, to create containers and get them to run. We'll let Dan talk about that specifically in the second half today. He's actually going to provide some live demo of container stuff. But when you compare a container to your traditional virtualization, I'm going to jump slides here. In traditional virtualization, you basically abstract the operating system away from a piece of hardware. So through software emulation, the virtualization technology advertised with generic CPU, generic network interface, a generic storage interface, and then as long as the software had enough device drivers to support, what was being advertised as an interface, then it could run in that virtualized environment. right? You had the VMware days, you had the bus logic's cousin driver with like the initial disk interface there. Over time, they could kind of come up with their own. And so you basically had the operating system talking to a software stack, completely abstracted away from the fact that it wasn't really hardware, it was all software. This provided great isolation, so you can install multiple operating systems on a single piece of hardware. You can install different versions of the same software on the same hardware, so RHEL 4, RHEL 5, RHEL 6, you can, you know, mix it up. Then arguably you had better security because everything from the operating system down was isolated and basically wrapped in this emulation layer. And then over time you got all these other things like vMotion, right? You want to take a virtual machine that's running on this server and you want to have it move to another server without shutting the VM down. Therefore, you know, you can upgrade the firmware, replace hard drives or whatever on this piece of equipment, but the application never will apply. So you have live migration, live storage migration, and all these other features that VMware and KVM and Red Hat virtualization provide that basically built on top of traditional stuff. Yeah.
Is that compete with like ESX?
Yes. So when I speak of VMware, I'm talking specifically ESX, vCenter.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
So where vCenter is kind of the single pane of glass, that console that allows you to manage, I don't know, what is it, up to like 60 some odd ESX hosts.
Yep.
And then once you go beyond that, then you have to get another vCenter and then you get more. So basically create these compute,
mm-hmm.
I don't want to use the term cloud because that's not right, cluster, create an ESX cluster. So Red Hat virtualization is much the same way. When you say ESX, Red Hat virtualization would be RHEL enabled KVM. And then once you stand up those hosts, you want to have some kind of a management console, then you run the Red Hat Enterprise Virtualization Manager, and that creates the GUI with all the, you know, when you live migrate everything from the plug and stuff. Containers, on the other hand, instead of extracting the operating system away from the hardware, containers abstract applications away from the operating system. So if you go a level higher, when your applications interact with the OS, it looks for things like, you know, an IP address, it looks to interact with mount points in the file system. And if you can take those things away that make the operating system unique, now you can run multiple applications on the same host without the penalty of running in a fully virtualized environment. And that penalty is performance and scalability. So, back to this other slide. And let me go here. Just make it more natural. So, when you deal with container technology, there's basically four key challenges that you have to look at. Resource management, right? So if you have applications running in containers, you need to be able to control how much CPU, network, disk I/O, particular container can consume from the host. You need to look at process isolation. A lot of this plays into security or other resource management aspects so that, you know, one program can't do a PSEF and get all the process IDs that are being running on the host because now that program is no longer isolated. It has visibility into the rest of the operating system. So you need to pick pieces of the OS, isolate those things. Then of course there's the real security, which we've implemented with SE Linux. And then you need some kind of a convenient management tool that puts all these different aspects of the operating system together and then allows you to use containers in a nice, easy way, the same way you use today's virtualization. So as Dan mentioned, you know, parts of Linux containers and parts of what we call the kernel namespace have been showing up in Linux over quite a while. Some people argue LXC has been around for a long time, but there's a lot of these puzzle pieces that LXC doesn't implement, therefore the whole container story is not really there yet. But with RHEL 7, Fedora 20, name your upstream community, you know, everything's kind of migrated to these sets of technologies now. Talking about C groups is a resource management capability that was introduced in RHEL 6. Basically allows you to lump processes and threads into groups and then dictate percentage of CPU, percentage of network I/O, disk I/O, and memory that your particular groups can consume. So if you think of installing multiple Oracle databases on a single host, it's great because now you don't have to pay the licensing fees, but if you want to put your development and production Oracle databases together on the same machine, you're always worried that your development guys are going to consume all your resources. Right? They're going to more disk IO, use up more memory, whatever. But with cgroups, you can basically implement two Oracle servers on the same box, constrain one to use minimum resources, and the production one always gets what's guaranteed to it. So that's the idea of what cgroups is going to provide. Kernel namespaces and this process isolation, there's six of these various namespaces, five of which were delivered in RHEL 6.5. The last one, which is the user space, user namespace, won't be delivered until RHEL 7. So depending on what you want to do with containers, there's a lot you can do with the core plumbing that exists today. But if you want to get to the Docker story that really wraps everything up in a nice user interface, then you have to wait for a SE Linux will cover, and the libvirt LXE and the Docker. So libvirt is a virtualization API. It was developed to basically provide an abstracted API layer so that as Red Hat initially in RHEL 5, we were investing in Xen technology, which is the core of virtualization. But already then we brought it to market with the libvirt API kind of wedged between. So you weren't using Xen commands to manage, you were using libvirt commands, like the virt shell, et cetera. And so the container model is being adapted to plug into libvirt. So that's going to happen in conjunction with Docker, that's also going to show up on the website. Okay, so back up to. Why containers? You missed the Texas story earlier, debating the Six Flags of Texas. We can rehash it up here.
Thank you.
So why containers? I mean, container technology in one form or another has existed in other operating systems for a while. You're familiar with Solaris Zones. There was another Linux-based container technology. What was it called?
IBM has LFCI. IBM has, I think it's LFCI. Which
in AIX?
Yeah.
Or
no, it actually runs on the vSurvey, but it can run on Z Linux.
What's that down on the table?
It's LFCI. I can look it up. I was just looking at that today for
IBM developed LFC tools.
Yeah, right.
LFC tools is just this tool set to be able to all the things that are
virtuoso? No.
OpenBZ.
OpenBZ. So similar kinds of technologies to implement and run containers. And the reason they're interesting because all your applications of running container run on the same kernel as running the host. So you don't pay the virtualization penalty of performance. So in essence, you don't have to worry about starting and shutting down operating systems when you launch containers. So container start time could be seconds versus lots of seconds.
Here's right, is a true compartment of steroids.
Can be, yep. And as we kind of talk about the namespaces, that'll explain. I'm going to do a lot of hand waving because I don't have those slides to make it. But essentially, what John just mentioned is everybody familiar with Chroot? Anybody not familiar with Chroot? No. The idea of Chroot is, let's say you run an FTP server. FTP servers usually consider one of those insecure things that's easily attacked. And so if you could contain that server in a what's called a Chroot environment, you run a command and it basically puts FTP and all the binary it refers to into a separate directory. And And then anything running from an FTP server can only work within that file system. So if somebody attacks the FTP server, can get out, basically get to a shell. The only things they can attack are things that are installed inside that Cherub environment. So containers are much the same way. You're taking an application and you're cherubing it into namespaces now, where you're basically isolating it from more than just the file system. But you're also allowing it to have a shared piece of the operating system. It gets to use the same kernel, you can share different mount points, you can share file systems and libraries and all the things from the operating system. And then you can overlay, you know, basically as you build the container, you can overlay components of the operating system. So if you set up an HTTP server and you wanted it to have its own var temp directory, you can embed var temp in the container, and then it would overlay essentially what the operating system was. So then this brings up the concept, well, how much do you want to share with the operating system? If in the container you want to share everything with the OS, so that you basically have that model of, I'm going to patch the operating system once, and now all my containers will automatically be patched. This is, I think Solaris used the term, the root zone. So if you patch the root zone, and then all of your other Solaris zones use that same root zone, then all the containers automatically get patched. The problem is, if you patch the root zone, you have to take all your applications offline because you're patching one area and you have to reboot it. So you have this dilemma. Do you share everything and get the advantages of, you know, I only have to patch things once, I only have to deploy one package in one place, but I've got my 10 virtual machines and my 10 containers can use them all? Or do I want to have the applications have more autonomy, like traditional virtualization, and basically bundle an entire operating system in the container along with the application? And now when I deploy my app, I'm basically deploying an entire stack of RHEL minus the kernel with the application as a container, and then it gets mounted up and running. Depending on your environment, that you can have the argument both ways. Operations people usually don't like containers because it means now that, you know, containers typically mean I'm scaling up. I want to run 1,000 applications on a single machine. And if I've got a container installed in here, that's potentially having to patch 1,000 different machines. Yeah?
So what's the meaning of application? Could it be a complete, say, lab stack with the web application that runs on it?
Yeah. Okay.
Would that be a typical thing to do, or is that more than typical?
I think the intent, especially behind like a Docker container, is to build everything that delivers a particular service in that. Are we using the term gear for that, or are we? They'll call me a container. OpenShift calls it a gear.
No, in Docker terms, Docker likes, the guys that are developing Docker want individual services each in the container. So they would say that a lamp stack would have one for your web server, one for your database, one for your middleware. So you would have multiple. Now, that being said, there's no problem with doing them all in the same container.
So containers then can talk to each other, cooperate, so you can have a web server container, an application server container, a database.
The standard way people get in containers to talk together now is over the network, though, so it'll be over local. So you open up ports on certain machines inside of a virtual network on the machine.
In performance terms, is that like a Unix pipe?
Yeah, I mean, it's close to a Unix pipe. Yeah, that's one of the ideas. But other people are building, you know, people have built all the way up to full booting operating systems inside. So not that I suggest that you should do that.
All right, so I can play it either way. Yeah, I can split my stack into components.
Right. You built a tool, a Libra sandbox that was running a system view in this system inside of this system to launch individual services inside of the container. And we're planning on doing something similar for Docker. Right now, Docker is more about running a single server, single Apache server inside of the container, single highest for all the time.
Thank you. Question?
Yeah.
Basically,
I'm just thinking of kind of lightweight DM, and then you can kind of think they're like more finer grade of, you know, resource control, right?
Yes.
Like how finer is it, like for example, CPU, like DM? You can assign a number of like cores, you know, if you want to assign to DM and things like that, right? So, you know, in container, do you have these finer grade already? Like,
where is your experience? What's your practical experience with assigning cores for a virtual machine? Is it VMware? Or do you have
the KVM, yes, yeah, the KVM.
So you, even today, because KVM is basically a single process running on host, you can apply cgroup policies to the KVM virtual machine. So with some planning, you can take your virtual machines, pin them to CPUs, you know, or whatever, and then use cgroups to further divide how one VM could starve another VM from service.
Like, I'd say, you know, 20% of CPU resources is continuing to use them.
Yep.
Can you do that, like, even, what about the, you know, like, can you utilize that one? And use, like, you know,
So when I kind of finish with this, I'm going to do some demo stuff. I'm going to cover CPU, network, and disk for C groups. And then when I'm done with that, he's going to do Docker and talk about containers. Any other questions? Okay, so we covered that. Okay, so basic use cases. I mean, we've kind of already covered already. Like you mentioned, you know, resource constraints. You want to stop MariaDB. MySQL for using system memory. Private file systems, you know, you want one container to have a different file system than the standard host file system. Private networking, basically prevent an app from getting off the host. Security confinement. And then as you move into cases with RHEL 7, the sys5 init process upstart is being replaced with systemd, and the goal is to have systemd basically manage all the containers and cgroup policies. So basically you'll have one choke point that basically runs the entire box, and then there'll be APIs and family tools to basically operate through systemd to reallocate and repurpose your resources. And you know, here's examples, and I'm going to run multiple instances of JBoss or couple of different versions of PostgreSQL, but with different configs in place. Okay, so we talked about that, we covered this. So out of curiosity, is the fonts and stuff in the boxes, is that okay to read in the back? Or is that too small?
Too small.
Right.
Yeah, memory is kind of getting small here, but plausible.
Right. But you can see this, well, it's also out of focus, but the C groups, those fonts, those are okay. Kernel interfaces, stuff's in bold.
Yeah, bold.
Alright, that's my font test. Okay, let's jump out of slides and talk more about Redo. Okay, so I am leveraging shells, one of which I'm root, but I can get out of that and I just do a sudo su dash. And what I'm going to do in the interest of not having to type everything, I have my little cheat sheet of commands. Okay, so the focus right now is cgroups. So everything obviously here is RHEL 6. Cgroups is still around in RHEL 7. A little bit different implementation because it's going to be command through systemd. Are the cgroup command line utilities going to be the same?
You can still use the existing
prefer not to just use this to be.
Obviously, the objective is here's things you can play with and use that. All right, so my objective now is I want to basically implement some network policies and find some means to test the network policy and show that there's some difference in the changes that you make. And so I'm going to create a C group. Well, first I'm going to clear it. So there's a command called CG clear. Make sure everything's cleared off. And I'm going to clean my network traffic control queue as well. He's clear. All right. C-groups are implemented in a virtual file system, much like FlashProc. So you have command line utilities that work in libc-group to create things. You can use commands like cg-group, or you can use traditional file system commands like linker and echo parameters into files to basically create C-groups. I'm going to use the latter set where I'm just going to make theirs and create things this way. Here, this is what the C group file system looks like when it's first set up. And if I'm using the right terminology, we call these various subsystems within the C groups. So they look like mount points. And then I'll pick these mount points and I'll mount them over to my my resources that I create. So then essentially I'll create a C group hierarchy and then mount the subsystems to that. Therefore, basically, now if I created other hierarchies. Am I using the right terminology for that? When I create my hierarchy, and yeah. Close enough. You can't use the various resources in multiple places. So there are some things you have to understand about how you can set up these things. You can't just go crazy and arbitrarily make stuff. There's rules in place of how you can reuse resources in various hierarchies. So first up, I'm going to create this test 01. Okay, size-wise, or do I need to pop it up?
That's good.
Okay. And I'm also going to get rid of the color, because the color's not my thing. Better? Mm-hmm. Anybody else colorblind besides me? So if there's something red and I'm being oriented, you'll know why. Alright, so make directory test 1. Alright, so this creates basically the root of my C group hierarchy. And the only thing that I'm going to leverage is this net CLS subsystem. And it's basically using the mount command. And I'm going to, when I finish this documentation, it'll all get published. And I'm happy to present this at the summit. It'll all be in there. And the documentation at the summit so it's available for people to download. All right, so I create the mount point. And now I'm going to create a. So within that C group, I'm now creating a name of a group, and I'm going to assign the tasks that I run into this group, and then I'm going to basically throttle this particular group so that it performs a specific way. All right, so now that's done. This is the only piece of magic that took me a while to figure out what to create. All right, so what NetCLS does is it basically adds a tag to all the network traffic that comes in and out of the processes that are running within the C group. That tag can then be inspected by TC, which is the normal traffic shaping utilities that Linux provides. So once that tag shows up and TC can grab it, then you can implement TC type parameters to dictate traffic flow. So this parameter creates this tag, and this is a hexadecimal value. And had to look it up online. But you must know. You'll see here in a second what that correlates to. Alright, so this is the command to clear my TC queuing disciplines. Alright, lots of values in here that I don't necessarily understand. HTTP, I think, is the high traffic bucket or something along those lines. The what?
Hierarchical.
The hierarchical traffic bucket? Okay. end here, I scrolled off the edge, but basically I'm setting a rate of 500 bits per second. And then the last thing to do is to attach a filter. So that sets up that pulse. All right. So now the trick is, well, great, I've got the C group set up. How do I get my processes to run independent? So this is actually pretty straightforward. I can either use a command like cgexec, where I can cgexec, pass a couple of parameters, and then specify the command that I want to run. And then basically cgexec takes care of setting up and getting the C group and all the processes so isolated. I'm going to do it a little bit different because this actually explains it better. Everybody knows dollar dollar. I echo dollar dollar. I'll enlarge this in just a second, but that's basically giving me the process ID of my shell, which is 2241. Now here, I'm going to go into my two shells, one shell which I have now supposedly constrained in my C groups, and one shell which I haven't. So let's play with the shell that I haven't yet. And so what this command is doing is basically just running an SSH to my host. Remind you, remember this. This machine that we're playing on is a virtual machine that's running in KVM. And I'm now using C groups within the VM. And that machine is basically going to my host to retrieve a file. So I'm basically just using SCP to grab something over the virtualized net. Notice that it's dragging pretty slow and that, you know, it's going to take, what, 13, 15 minutes to pull everything over. So I'm going to run into my other shell here and run the exact same command. And I'll show you the output, I'll show you the contents of this command in just a second so you can see it's doing SCP. And so basically he's almost running at full speed. Same command, two different shells, one's dragging forever, the other one's just going to crank right along. It takes about 15, 20 seconds. So now if you want to go back and change, you know, the throughput rate, there's another TC command that allows me to do that. Basically, here's the change parameter. I'm changing my rate to 1 megabit. I'm going to let him finish just to show that he's going to go. So he's done up there. So everybody happy that we've shown that we can control network throughput with C groups. This has nothing to do with containers. This is simple C groups, and I've contained everything that runs. So anything in the top shell that'll execute, if I create new child process or whatever, everybody inherits the same C groups. So in fact, when I go run this command, if I cap my tasks, you'll see that my original shell process is still there. If I go run the command and now cap tasks again, you'll see that the other process IDs for the other things that spun off are also contained within the same C group. Which brings up the point that you can certainly go in now and manipulate and remove things out of there. So if something's spun spun up and you want to pull something out of the C group and return it back to the regular pool, you can do that, just simple stuff. All right. Okay. So now let's do this. Let's play with iPerf. So iPerf is a utility. It's not part of RHEL, but it's available in the EPEL repo, E-P-E-L. Who's familiar or not familiar with the EPEL repo? So standard RHEL, you connect the Red Hat, you can get all the supplementary, the Red Hat channels, and the other stuff. EPEL is a separate repo. It's part of the Fedora distribution. And basically, it's where Red Hat engineers repurpose and repackage some technologies into RPMs that fit cleanly on Red Hat. So there's an EPEL repo for RHEL 5. There's an EPEL repo for RHEL 6. And you can find great utilities like iPerf available. These aren't things you could call Red Hat for support for because they're community projects. They're just rebuilt for Red Hat enterprises. But most of these projects are developed and run by Red Hat employees, so they usually just go to the community and say, okay, well, they need to fix the paperwork. Okay, so in the iPerf world, you have to have a server and a client.
Michael mentioned that iPerf is available for other operating systems as well.
Okay, you mean like
Windows and OS X and Solaris?
Multi-platform.
Nice. Okay, so this is not very interesting, but all in large, I just want to run it here. So basically, you're in iPerf-S, sets up the server. Okay? I'm going to shrink him back out of the way. And then I'm going to come down here, and I'm going to run the iPerf client. It basically runs a throughput test. You can see that the connection came in on this side. It'll send a bunch of packets back and forth and say, woohoo, you've got this much throughput. And the throughput between like RHEL 6 and RHEL 7 is much better on RHEL 7. So you'll see certain tests we do with RHEL 7. Okay, so bandwidth, 10 gigabits per second. Let's go run the same test up here. I did actually set it up to 10 megabits, so I'll throw this guy back out the one. That wasn't efficient. So, hopefully it comes back and it says, okay, I've got roughly 1 megabit throughput. So it's just another way of validating that the changes that we're implementing through TC actually work. Alright. So that's that test. Any more questions on networking? And this, again, this will all be published. And the stuff that I found online didn't all seem that well coherent, so it took me a little while to work.
So you can also block certain ports or certain addresses as well using PC and similar things, or just do flow rate control?
I'm not that familiar with PC. You're shaking your head yet? No? So blocking ports and stuff, I would probably rely on IP tables.
Okay. Can you attach an IP table to a C group then?
No. Okay. Yeah, so it's system-wide, everything that comes in, IP tables, is basically the front door. And then once it gets in the door, then basically TC implements the queuing disciplines for flow control.
If you wanted to have different rules for all processes on the system based on IP tables rules. You can do that through using the network namespace if you want to.
instead of virtual network interfaces?
You can have that with network namespace, you can actually have totally different IP addresses across. In some cases, you can also eliminate the network altogether, so the process will be the network process.
Well, that raises a question about containers. If I've got a web container, an application server, a database server container, do they have different IP addresses?
They can.
They can.
All right, well, one of the things that you didn't really cover was you have the choice of it. Containers can store something. There's no such thing from a Linux kernel point of view, there's no such thing as a container. So with what, as he was showing in his talk, there was three different sort of key components to what people think build up containers. Those are C groups for resource management. So you want to do processes, which is showing right now, to be behave differently. It can somehow contain based on resource utilization. That's what C groups is. Secondary part is security confinement, which is what I guess Linux does. And then the third component is the thing called namespaces. Namespaces are, there's five namespaces we take advantage of right now. There's actually a sixth one coming along. But the five namespaces are IPC namespaces. Semaphore the memory allocations for process, so you can have the same shared memory segment in different containers and not really be the same. Process namespace, which is basically everybody has their own slash prod. They can't see other process on the system, just process it inside the namespace. Network namespace, which is the full networking stack, we have IP tables, rules, routing tables, everything. Mount namespace, you have a totally different way of looking at the system for what's mounted. So I can have a slash tab. Slash template to do all the different things. Or in the case of Docker containers, the entire operating system from slash down is different for each container. And then there's also one called the UTS namespace, which allows you to have different host names, so the processors can have different host names in the system. The sixth namespace that's not currently is allowed in Rawhide, Fedora Rawhide, I think the bunch might have turned it on by now. It's called the user namespace. The user namespace allows you to different UID, have the same UIDs in different processes, and those UIDs are actually different. So inside of a namespace, you could have a UID zero, that is a billing UID zero, but you would be root. So you would have root controls of your namespace that would not have root control over the system. The problem with that namespace is that it just came out last summer. It's really, we're from a RHEL point of view, RHEL 7 point of view, we're a little worried about turning it on right now. The future RHEL 7 release will probably be turned on, so it's
going to answer your question.
Just confuse you more. I'm getting there. I'm interested in just that question about whether you can say in my web container can only take traffic that comes in on port 80 and 443, and my database can only take traffic on 3306.
What you can do is you can, in your container, you would set up a network namespace and then you would relay those ports into your container. So those containers would not even have access to the real Ethernet on your box, and you would then set up the port 80 and be relayed to this container, and port, the database port would be relayed into the other container. But those inside of the container, they wouldn't even have access to the real network.
So an actual software firewall.
It's like it's only our relay. Basically, it's being relayed into the container. It's very, you can do the same thing with virtual machines. So
the container only sees what is relay.
Right. You're holding packets so they can come into it.
And how do I set up relays? What are the software tools?
That's what the man in the tool.
Docker tool. Yeah.
How they do that?
That's what Libvirt, LXC, and Docker. They take all that. How do I set all the stuff up in the device community?
Do you know what the underlying technology that those tools use? Is it using a global virtual LAN?
It's actually, I think the network relays is actually taken advantage by the tables. So you can set up the relay rules.
Okay.
Just to kind of same way I said before, traditional virtualization extracted an operating system away from the hardware. Here you're taking your application, you're extracting it away from the operating system. So all those things that made the operating system unique, like IP, hosting, non points, the application has a different set of visors on it that looks at the operating system. And so that's what the namespace provides, this different set of visors, so that you can have two databases, both thinking that they have exclusive access to the operating system when they're actually working in a virtualized application container. Just taking it one level higher than that. And when it gets really interesting, I mean, the reason this technology is really interesting is because as we move into cloud computing, if you look at like Amazon, the EC2 cloud, right, that's more like traditional virtualization with like heavily automated tools that they build. So when you swipe your credit card and you say, I want a large Amazon EC2 instance, they spin up a virtual machine, much like KVM. Well, they're using Zen and KVM technologies, but I don't think that's any kind of secret. So they spin up a virtual machine. You can ask for RHEL, get Red Hat Enterprise Linux in there. Well, if you install Red Hat Enterprise Linux 6 into this virtual machine that's running in Amazon, then you can further subdivide the resources using containers. Because containers is strictly a software technology that runs within the kernel, now you can leverage containers and basically, you know, if you're installing 1,000 developers onto a single machine, everybody works at different times. That's like the perfect use case of, wow, let's use a container. And I know this guy uses more of the equipment than this guy does, so I'll create a C group to basically make sure that his utilization of the host doesn't unfairly attack everybody else. And you can actually now with containers provide SLA, and yet even better, continue to use traditional virtualization, so you get all those other benefits of hardware consolidation, abstraction, vMotion, all the redundancy options that already exist, right? So containers isn't a containers versus traditional first kind of argument. So you can do both. Alright. Back to a quick demo on the seekers, and I think we want to talk more about Docker because that seems to be more container stuff. Okay, so now I'm going to do a quick demonstration of some disk IO stuff. So CG clear. So the parameters here that you enter is I'm going to, so the parameters you enter is the major number, minor number, and this is the major number, minor number for my disk. So if I do the normal VDA, since this is the virtual disk, my major minor numbers are 252 and 0. So basically I've created a C group that's going to restrict access to the entire disk. You can do it by partition, whatever, because the major minor numbers will change for each partition. But for the purposes of today's example, I'm just saying anything that's going to run out of that shell is going to have a reduced throughput rate to that particular drive. All right. top of my disk. I'm going to not care about writing it anywhere. I'm just starting into dev null. Set my block size to 1 meg and my count for 5. And I don't have permission. I've had this book before. But you want it. Yeah, I know, but I don't think I went to root for this one. I know I didn't change the parameters, so I did it. That's a little bit different.
But you know, you're reading all of slash?
Well, he's reading.
No, I'm just reading the first 5 megs of a disk from VDA.
Yeah, but you're going to be able to do that.
I know. Which makes me wonder what my test was earlier today when I verified that this was working. Basically, even my sudo should now be, let's look if I don't. Yeah, so I've done my sudo to a root shell, so then the root shell should also be within the C group.
And when you exit that process, the ID will disappear from the password?
Yes. All right, so this is the non-constrained one. Oh, wait, I got to drop my cache. All right, so it's still working. So, okay, I must have done the SU root before. So basically, I ran it up top, and it took, 12 seconds to execute. I ran it down to the bottom, and it took roughly less than a second, so almost 0.08. And I can change the throughput rate. Notice that I set it to, this is IOPS per second, or IOs per second, and I can, if I reduce it further, it'll take forever. And I set both the read and write, even though I'm not writing anything, but this really wouldn't make a difference. And now if I change this value and go rerun the test, make sure I drop the cache. Everybody know Control R for Bash? Recall. So if you're on the shell and you can hit Control R, then you can. And the old case shell used to do the escape V to the arguments. Okay, so now we rerun this after I drop my patches. Should be a little quicker, but still not as fast, so not double. Mm-hmm. Alright, so you can kind of show the block I was doing what it's supposed to do. Okay, last demo.
So you control bandwidth to a particular block device. No, it totally independent of file systems.
Correct. So the block IO parameters are major minor numbers.
Okay. If you're built up, if you're using the MD driver, where you built up a RAID thing of underlying actual hardware IO.
So the MD device, that gets a major minor number in the file system.
So you restrict at that level. If you did something really strange and you restrict the performance on one of the underlying hardware devices but you mounted the file system on the MD device, do you have any idea whether you would still restricted access to IO that went to that disk from a container restrained process, or has it been filtered through by or into the MD device so it's no longer visible?
You lost me.
No clue.
All right, no one will want to do it anyway, but if you have an MD device that's like a RAID 1, there's two underlying hardware devices, and I put an IO restriction on one of those two hardware devices, but I'm accessing it through the MD device block device number, it would seem to me it may not be visible that a process is accessing it through the MD device should be restricted when it goes to one of those two underlying hardware devices.
All right, so if I understand what you're saying, you set up a C group policy that says my process can't write to...
Can't write fast to
Dev
this.
A. Can't write to fast to Dev A.
Yeah.
But you do it at that level. But when the process is actually running, he's interacting with the EMD device.
Which happens to use Dev A as one of its underlying storage devices.
That seems like you wouldn't really get that restriction because then it's the kernel moderating for you or something.
Yeah, I would think it probably wouldn't happen, but yeah, I was just curious.
That's kind of picking you up bad at the wrong level, I think.
Sure. Interesting thing.
Create a support ticket?
Pardon?
All right, so last demo here real quick. We'll do the bouncy ball demo. Some of you may have seen this before, some of you not, but this gives you an example of CPU resource restrictions. So I'm going to... Doing everything by command is wonderful and great, and it's like a good first step to start playing with the technology, but obviously you don't want to go into creating a lot of shell scripts and stuff to echo these things around. So the main config file is cgconfig.conf and etc. Looks something like this. The idea is you basically, well, of course you can read the man page, but you mount up the subsystems that you plan to use. You create your group. So where I say group 1, group 2, this is basically where I said test 01 and test 02. You can also then further define, like, to do task manipulation within the C group. You can identify, like, an administrative user, somebody who's non-root, but yet can add and remove tasks from the bigger C group. And then, of course, there's the administrative user that can, you know, manipulate things. I've got it set to me, but I'm just going to do it again. Okay, then in CPU set, you define which CPUs you want to use. I define how many shares, so I just create an arbitrary value and say, this is how many shares the CPUs, and I can divide that up into the various C groups. Do that for my other group as well. So the group's already created, and so now all I'm going to do is run a couple of processes. And one of those is, that's going to... Okay. So, here's a command cg exec, which is basically control group's going to execute a command for me, but as it does that, it's going to bind it into my group 2 C group with the enabled subsystems of CPU, CPU set, and something called freeze or something like that. And the last parameter basically tells SM spray how many threads do I want to run. And to make sharing CPUs interesting, you want to have multiple threads because I want to be able to saturate the machine. I mean, otherwise, if you don't saturate the box, the CPUs really don't have much purpose. Because they set kind of a high water margin, so that you only get 10% even when the box is busy. Okay. You know what? I'm going to reduce this so that it's a little bit.
Did you say C groups are only useful if you're doing your provisioning badly?
What's that? If you're provisioning poorly, like in VMware or something?
If you're putting 50 pounds of shit and putting it on SAC, then C groups are useful. Seems to be what you just said. It's only useful if you're hitting the wall.
Right. So you're C groups won't starve a task unless there's other tasks that are waiting for that same resource. So you're not going to, if you're running a single HTTP server that doesn't have to share a system, there's no point to a C group. If you have five C groups, or five tasks, and they're sharing the same C group, but none of those tasks is saturated machine, then you're still not really benefiting from the C group. What the C group is interesting is, you know, you've got a limited amount of resources, and you want to guarantee that one thing won't starve the other. And this will actually prove the point here.
If one of them's hitting the wall, or collectively they'll add up to more than you've got, then this determines what the fair allocation is.
Yes.
So this is for CPU, that it's a soft limit, not a hard limit.
Yes.
Whereas in the I.O. Controller, it was clearly a hard limit. Nothing else, no other I.O. was going in your machine, but we're still limited to the throughput that you specified.
In those particular parameters, right? That, right. That was the I.O.s.
So
right.
Some of them are hard and some of them are soft.
Is that fair?
Yeah, in the CPU, we have both.
You can do both.
We can do, if you want to throttle someone, you can throttle.
Okay.
But yes, if it's each C group, memory is kind of a weird one, because You can't take memory away from somebody other than killing them.
Right. Yeah. Right.
So you can say memory is usually a hard limit. And what happens when that processing the hard limit, they'll start swapping.
Sure.
And also, who would kill it would be more likely to fix them those constraints.
All right. So real quick, this won't take for a second. I'm using a small command line utility called CGBuddy. This is only an application somebody within Red Hat wrote to basically demonstrate how libc group would work. And so here I'm basically showing the CPU shared allocated to group one and group two, the CPUs that are apart, and then of course this thing called the freezer state. Now the freezer is actually interesting because I can click one and then I can identify. And you'll see that the other one obviously picks up right away. So just by freezing one process, the other process gets to use the available CPU capacity. So unfreeze him. I can divide his CPU shares in half, so now everybody's running at about bouncing between 17 and 20 hertz. Divide his resources down, and now the other guy benefits, right? So the other one picks up a little bit more. If I further remove his CPU shares, I can really make it painful. I can remove him and basically only give him one core now. Now it gets really competing because he's sharing the same core. He's getting 512 shares where the other guy is really getting more resources. So the math gets kind of fuzzy in 3.10. Now he's benefiting from the single core, like the guy with the full core. All right, demonstrating CPU shares. Everybody cool? All right, let's talk about containers. Dan? Yeah.
Can you do it with GPU too?
Can we do what?
Can you do it with GPU?
GPU.
Can you parachute that GPU resources too?
GPUs?
Good progress.
Yeah.
Right. If you're doing GPU
yeah.
Programs.
Yeah.
Fair enough. Not
the C group. Idea of the future.
Yeah, I think you can do that. You can do that.
That's what the community is for.
Do you know, anybody know if the sound actually works?
It does in some rooms.
That's a good sign. You just blew the speaker.
The only advice I have, don't push on that end of the table or sit on it. It's not afraid it'll go over. It does go over.
Gary demonstrated earlier.
I think I ran into that the last time I was in here when Brian had a meeting.
Yeah. Yeah, Earl 7 doesn't hide the password.
Make you look.
It'd be real weird since it's not dry, so it would be also interesting.
But I had locked myself out today. I started to change my user ID. And then get distracted. Oops. And so my user ID could change, but not the shadow.
Ooh.
Yeah, that's good.
So he, most of what he was showing was on Route 6. And Route 6, in order to use C groups, you really have to, you have to go into the work that he was doing. Route 7, System D, which is the new init system, will actually automatically put all processes into C groups. And all processes will be based on what's called a fair share algorithm, especially for CPU. That means that out of the box, every service will have its own C group, every user will have its own C group, every virtual machine will have their own C group, and each one of those C groups gets equal share of the operating system. So if you have a user that goes into its license system and forks off 1,000 processes, he won't get 1,000th of the system, or a huge portion of his processing won't get a huge portion of the system, he'll still get only one. One cut that the users get in the system.
So our system is a sheet.
It's interesting, Route 7, everybody, you're going to need C groups all the time. Okay. Matter of fact, if you run Fedora 20, 21, all your processes are running inside of C groups. Okay. They're not constrained C groups. We weren't setting up any constraints that he was showing there, but they're constrained in that each one of them gets a equal slice of the system. So there's no way a process can run off and by default. So the other thing he talked about was containers. So the last year and a half I was working on the thing we was talking about the LXC stuff, Libert LXC, and we were designing something called Libert Sandbox. And with Libert Sandbox's idea was to have individual parts of the take your slash user and make that sort of read-only into containers. Slash bar be container specific, and we were looking at allowing you to run multiple Apache servers, MySQL, stuff like that. What happened though is Docker came along. Now, how many of you have heard of Docker before today? So Docker was, let me go through them. I'm going to put up some slides that you guys shouldn't see, but don't tell anybody. Show you've been made in public, and I like the stretch rules. So Docker, so we were working on our stuff, and very happy, thinking, oh, this is really cool stuff. And this company, .cloud, who was actually a competitor against OpenShift, which is Red Hat's version of PaaS, and actually we kind of killed their PaaS server. OpenShift is way more popular than their PaaS server. But when they were building their PaaS server, they developed this technology called Docker. And they started working on it last January. And then in March, they released it as an open source package. And it became the most popular package on GitHub. So it had 10,415 stars on it, which means 10,000 people went in and said, that looks great. It's also had 1,600 forks. That means people that are trying to actually build look at the software and actually add contributions. And out of those, we've had 362 different people have contributed to the software, including many Red Hat people. So there's massive community interest in this. All the big players in the universe are looking at this, and this is like 25 guys in California are working on this. They're going to be very, very rich. So one of the things that they talk about, their analogy comes from looking at the shipping industry pre-1960. And before 1960, when you wanted to ship something, you had to worry about things like putting your fragile stuff next to stuff that's heavy, putting your food sources next to potentially hazardous waste. And you had all these different worries that you had doing shipping. So on the left, right-hand side is the actual people that wanted to ship product. On the left-hand side is actually the shipping companies. So the problem with the shipping companies is trying to load and get as much stuff onto a shipping vessel as quickly as possible with all different sizes of products. It was a real hassle.
shipping industry was rather in bad shape pre-1960. After the 1960s, they standardized on a container. Okay, so the shipping container became a standardized mechanism of shipping, and a user or a person that wants to ship something now only has to worry about sticking his stuff inside of the standardized container. Shippers, all they have to worry about is how to quickly load these containers onto their ships, build the ships around the standard, so you want to fit as many of these things onto your ship as possible. So through the standardization of shippers, that's where the algorithm of Docker, that's where the idea of Docker comes from. And that's why you'll see the whale with the containers on the back. The interesting thing is in the software industry, we really have the same problem. So we have developers that want to build tools, want to build their applications. They want to code, they want to build libraries, they want to test in one location. They want to set up the configuration, potentially the data, all inside their application stack. And then you have the people running the operating systems, the sysadmins out there, and what do they care about? They care about setting up the operating system, getting many applications running as possible. They want to start and stop the applications or containers. They want to do logging, see what these applications are doing, and monitoring them. And they want to usually configure like networks instead of networks. So you really have sort of a similar dichotomy that you had pre-1960 for the shipping industry. We actually have it in the software industry now. So in developers, what developers can do in a Docker environment is start to take advantage of an image-based system. At this point, people should be starting to think of, this is bundled. Okay? So this is bundling the operating system or the parts of the operating system that you need for your application to run can be bundled together, and then you can just ship that. So what does that do for the developer? He can test one environment. He can test his image on top of, gives him application mobility. The application is fully integrated into the operating system, and he allows to run his application on multiple different servers. So think of, you have a RHEL 7 box coming out, and you want to run a RHEL 6 application. What does he tell you developers? Oh, you can deploy your application in RHEL 6. In a container environment, you might be able to bring the entire RHEL 6 runtime environment, including the application, onto your RHEL 7 box and run it. Might even be able to do it with RHEL 5. You can do it with Ubuntu. You can bring Ubuntu applications onto a RHEL box, similar type thing. So that the idea here is that the entire user space with the application will shift. So it's not only containers, but it's this whole idea of the bundling of the user space with the application. On the administrator's point of view, he now can bring these applications in, and he can do things like he doesn't have to worry about patching as much, because the applications are going to bring a very small part, very small subsection of the user space. So if the container doesn't use SSHD, and SSHD has vulnerability in it, you don't have to worry about updating the application inside the container. So you might potentially have less patching in this type of environment, and you can get greater application density. So with containers, you can run the application density as compared to virtualization. So full virtualization is you're virtualizing an operating system. In a lot of cases, people wanted to use virtualization because they want to run two Apache servers on the box at a time. So would you rather just manage two Apache application stacks, or would you rather manage two operating systems? So we're going to look a little deeper at what Docker brings to the table. Docker has this idea of an image or a base image. In Red Hat's case, we're looking to ship RHEL 7 base images, RHEL 6 base images, potentially RHEL 5 base images. And these are really sort of read-only images that you very small, potentially as small as just having bin shell, the glibs, and maybe some core utilities, and that's about it. That's really the goal here, is to get these things to be as small as possible. And then you want to run a container on top of it. So when you install a Docker image, that is a piece of, it's all the software, but it's not running. When you run it, it's called a container. So when I'm running a writable container process inside of my, on top of my image, that basically you can go off and do anything it wants in the environment, inside of the container environment. When you exit out of it, the application goes away. So you can, by default, you can have the application be destroyed. And then you can start to build up layered, what they call layered images. So in this case, we just added two more layers to the image stack. We added an Apache daemon to the image, and then we've added JBoss on top of that. And now we're running a full containerized environment that's running JBoss on top of Apache, on top of a RHEL 7 system. If you run this environment and update it, and you want to stop it, you can actually create a new image based on the whole layers here. So if you went into one of these containers and did a yum update, to add additional software to it, and then said went outside of it and said did a Docker save, you would create a new image that you could then run. So the actual Docker commands, I'm going to do a little bit of a demonstration for you in a minute. You can run, just to run a Docker command, hello world, you can say Docker run, and then pick the operating system you want to run it on, a container you want to run it on, RHEL 7, and then just echo hello world. After you run that, when you run that command, even if you don't have a RHEL 7 image installed in your box, it will go out to a repository and bring the image onto your machine. So it can go out and find images in the environment and pull it in, and then it'll run hello world, exit the container, and you're done. If you want to just pull, say, a RHEL 6 image, you should be able to do that when we ship this thing. You should be able to pull the image in and then be able to allow us to run it at later times. If you wanted to list all the images, you can just do a Docker images. You can see sort of the output here of different images that are available.
What's unique about the RHEL 7 and RHEL 6 images? Just the operating system that's gone through the process of somebody building the container.
Right. So I mean, when Red Hat talks about what we're trying to do is we are going through a strict build process to build, create these images that you will allow, if you have a RHEL subscription, you'll be able to get RHEL images to run in your box. And then we also have a higher level of kind of certified applications. So currently you have a certified application that will be available via RPM or from a customer that's certified to run on a RHEL system. Now it'll be certified images that you can get running in the RHEL system.
Will those containers have their own kernel images, or they
share? No, kernel, the whole thing about containers is you're sharing the host kernel. So it brings up an interesting point. In a strictest containerized environment, the only thing you rely on is the host kernel. So you have an API. The only thing you really rely on is the API to the kernel. Everything you would bring everything along with it. As we look at doing some of the work we're doing right now is around plumbing, because most people don't want just a strict image. What they want is sort of some stuff leaking in, like syslog. Right? You want to have your syslog messages come out of the container and go into your journaling system. You might want to have identity provided to you. You might want to set up identity on your host and then have identity leaked into the container. So the container would have the same users and stuff like that. So there are different things that you want to plumb into the container. But in the strict case, the container just relies on the API.
But you can have whatever set of shared libraries you want that happens to.
Right, you don't even have to. You could, as I said, you could run Ubuntu.
As long as you run with that underlying sort of kernel.
You bring your own library, everything with you. Now you can't run Windows on these things.
Right, yeah.
It has to be something that can talk to the Linux kernel.
Right.
If you do like heavy multimedia or like desktop stuff, I'm supposing that the FireWire is not changed mid-Linux kernel. So if you're going to run something that used to rely on a RHEL 5 and then using the old FireWire stack, but you've got the new kernel, you have to be able to
process. Yeah, if the API at the kernel level has actually changed.
So it's an interesting problem. Is, you know, I can see, I think you're usually going to want the latest kernel and then use an older
set of libraries.
Libraries on top of it. As opposed to trying to run RHEL 7 on a RHEL 5 operating system.
Right? Yes. So,
but theoretically, as long as the API, as long as you are only using the passing kernel API that was available, you should be able to do that. So that we just covered really base images. We talked a little bit about layered images. Docker also has this concept of what's called a Docker file. And what a Docker file is actually a script that can allow you to build these layered images. And it's a really fairly simple. So if you said, here I have an example of from rel 7, that tells the that tells this image you're building that's going to have a base image of rel 7. Then you can run the yum install inside your container, or inside your build. And that would, in this case, we're installing MongoDB on top of the base image. Then you were asking about the networking configuration inside the container. I can say I'm going to only expose one port to the network. So in this case, we're exposing port 2707. Volume tells it to actually mount the host operating system directory into the container. So in a lot of cases, you run a container, you really don't want any data that you're writing to sit inside the container. You want it so sort of on a shared on the host file system. So this would basically say, I'm going to put a database into slash data DB, and that will mount data DB off of the host into the container, try and mount it in.
That's an interesting loop.
Right, it's a directory from the root. It's in your namespace, but when you have a mount namespace, that just means your mount table is going to look different than the host mount table.
Like, that's like a real cheroot.
Yeah. So this would be like a cheroot, and then you buy mount it in this directory on top of it. And then the last one is actually a command to run. So you can, after you get the, if I just did a Docker start of this container I'm building, you would run that command. That's where you get to the one command per container. So again, this is sort of standard Docker. To build it, it's a fairly simple API. To do docker build -t, so you're naming it mymongo dot. When it's done, if you did a start of that image, it would run that container. Now, if someone else that comes along sees this thing and says, that's really cool, I'd like to use that in my image, he'd be able to build another Docker file that then would say from mymongo, add additional stuff. And now that's how you build up the layers. When you're using it too, the image is shared, so you're not duplicating all the software on your disk. So they're all going to share the same base image that you build these things up.
If my Mongo commits something to this image, though, if I used it, it appears in mine. If I lay it on top of him, but he's...
My Mongo is the read on the image. If anything he's running is in the
Okay,
so when you're running your container, you have the ability to save your container, but you're not going to create a MyMongo.
Okay,
you're going to create a new thing.
Got it.
And that's no matter what. Now, he could, if he based off of MyMongo, when you go and save a new version of MyMongo, he will still be based on your old version of MyMongo.
Okay.
Now, if he does a Docker build again, he will get you the new version. So like when we're shipping rel 7, so when we update the base image, you would have to go out to your images that were based on it and rebuild them.
Understood.
Each image also contains metadata, right?
Right. Yeah,
what the service looks like when it runs.
Right.
So besides just the data and the operating system in the application, it wraps additional data so that when the Docker gets launched, there's a configurable parameter. So you can take the same image and run it 100 times with 100 different parameters and have different host names and IPs and all the stuff so that basically one image can be deployed.
So other things that Docker
has. Yeah, I have a question about that.
Oh,
okay. Do the containers all share the same entry pool? The random number connection?
They're going to have dev random, rand mounted into the containers that's from the host.
Is there going to be an issue with that? Random entry perhaps?
Yes. Okay. One way to look at it is that you don't have to give them dev random if you don't want to. It's sort of your choice. You could have them sucking up random out of the system. But, in ways, these are just additional services running in the system.
C group.
Restrictive block cradle.
One of the interesting things they also have is they have this idea of registries. And that's what, remember I said you could do a Docker run rel 7. If you don't have a rel 7 image in your box, it will go out to a registry and actually grab a rel 7. So right now, if you ran Docker, say in Fedora box or your Ubuntu box, you would go out to Docker.io, the phone that you registered, you could get Ubuntu CentOS, everything but REPL. So in a RHEL environment, you can do Docker run RHEL, but you will probably go out to your satellite server or to your CDN or even out to access stuff and have the com and build the images if you have a subscription. You can set up private registries, but also once you have this, you can also have the ability to push. So you build that MongoDB container and you want to push it up to the registry, you have the ability to push it up and then have other people in your company actually pull it down. Or you could use that as a distribution. So now you can set up, you can push it up to the registry, you can set up 10 servers, and each one of those servers would be just doing a Docker run, MyMongo, you know, with different configurations. And even if they didn't have MyMongo on it, they would, you know, the first time they start out, it will suck it down to the box. You can name containers, and then you set up links, so you can actually link the containers together. We talked about that earlier, how you can hook up IP addresses. Ports between them so that they have the ability to be invited. So what Red Hat, where does Red Hat involve with this? So Red Hat, about 6 months ago, Sandbox, and all of a sudden we had people in Red Hat last summer come up and say, you know, we really need to look at this Docker thing. Docker's got Docker Hat. And one of the nice things, one of the great things about Red Hat and the great things about open source is that when you like to fail early, like before RHEL 7 ships. So we quickly figured out that we were going down the wrong path, or at least we were going down a path where we had very few people behind us while those trains going down the other track. So we decided to stop our losses and jump on the Docker bandwagon. So as of last September, we agreed with to work with Docker to start collaborating and try to make their product into what we consider enterprise ready. So we've been working with them. We've basically switched a lot of our engineering to working on Docker. And we've submitted many, many patches to Docker. One of the things Docker was working on was the AUFS, which is not in a actually was never put into the kernel, so we've written patches that now Docker uses DevNap that was provided by us. I personally added SE Linux support to Docker. We have lots of other patches that we're trying to get tied into the C groups better. And Docker right now is at a 0.9 release. It's not released as a supported product of Docker itself. They're hoping before RHEL 7 ships to have Docker 1.0. RHEL 7 ships, we will be supporting Docker, or we will not support Docker, it will be a, what we call a tech preview, mainly because we don't want to hook Docker up to the 10-year support cycle of RHEL. The reason for that is it's a brand new software, and we don't want to be, you know, 3 years from now, people saying, I know everybody has this really great Docker, but I want that Docker that you shipped when RHEL 7 came out, so we're not going to support it for the 10-year life cycle, but it will be supported at some point when we feel it's up to it. So going back down, one of the things that you, when you use Docker, you have to think about, you notice this Rolex has two X's in the name, you know, who are you going to trust? When you're looking at this software, you really have to start thinking about, you know, what am I installing on my box? One of my fellow engineers said Docker is great, it's all about people going out and getting random pieces of the software and then running it as root on their host operating system. So you have to start thinking about, you know, what's in these things. And so that's really where Red Hat, you know, that's our goal, is to make Red Hat sort of a choice platform for doing this. In some ways, this new imaging system is going to be a new way of distributing software. And if you think back before RHEL came out, back in, say, the year 2000, the way people distributed software on the internet was all sort of, go out to random websites and suck software into your box, and you do a make install, or you might get an RPM somewhere, and you ended up with these sort of weird environments that really could not be supported in the enterprise. So you couldn't even set up 50,000 of these boxes like, you know, most of the big banks are doing now. So you really needed a standardized way, a standardized software for stack, and that's really that's one of the reasons Red Hat's concentrated on it. But that's enough. Let me just show you a couple of interesting things that we're working on here. So in REL 7, System D has the ability to set, we talked about, we showed you all these tools that are available in REL 6 for setting up System D, setting up C groups. In REL 7, System D, which is a new NIST system, has a new format for what's called unit files. It's replacing sort of standard system disk scripts. And in a unit file, you describe what the application server is going to run. And you can actually put resource and C group configuration into your unit file. So this says here on the right hand, Apache container service tells it to run command when doing a docstat of a REL 7 Apache container. And then it says memory limit of 500K. So basically I've said that I want to run this application in my box, but I don't want to process it inside of it to no, have no more than half a gigabyte of memory. So System D then will launch Docker, and Docker will launch the container, and the process inside of the container will not be large and exceed 500K. Another interesting thing from System D is the idea of what's called socket activation. What socket activation allows you to do is to set up lots and lots of services on your system and not have them actually run until a packet arrives for the service to run. So in this case, we've set up an Apache environment that says I want System D to listen on port 80. If any connections come in from port 80, then launch the container. The container gets launched, and System D would actually push the connection to port 80 down to the Apache server, and the Apache server then would process it. This gives you the higher footprint, and you can put more and more services on your machines to this type of environment.
Oh, one question I've got is on sockets, they're usually timeouts together, right? Would that be able to start that service time to respond to?
Yeah, let me show you how quickly a container sets up.
Container starts as fast as the process starts.
Yeah. So here we have, hopefully this works. So in this container now, all it sees is two processes running. I happen to run bin shell as the process inside the container, and now it sees that that's my init system. So you see it's bin one. If I went outside the container now, that process is actually visible on the host operating system, and but it's not bin one, it's bin 3000 or something. So there's a different view of the operating system. If I went and looked at, say, slash, release, you'll see that this is running as Fedora 20, Eisenberg. If I did a cat, let's see, it would have release outside of the, you see that I'm running dry. So that shows that I'm running two different versions of Fedora. If I went, so I don't have CentOS installed in my box. So right now it's going out and it's actually pulling down CentOS. Hopefully the MIT network doesn't throttle me in a second. So it's actually going out to the Docker IO site right now. They're actually pulling down CentOS onto the box. And when that finishes.
About how big are these?
The goal is to make them as small as possible.
Yeah,
and
how possible is it?
The base image that we built for RHEL using standard tools was about 500 meg. I built a base image using a couple of tricks and got it down to 100 meg. So that's the image I'm talking about is an Apache image, so it runs Apache inside of it. It's funny as we've most of the tools used to build these things are standard things for installing operating systems,
sure,
like Anaconda. And so you have lots of things that want to put the kernel inside of these things, and we don't want the kernel. But know what uses up the most space on these images? Languages.
Translation.
So I always just wish that everybody just spoke English. Perhaps I'm a little. So we've actually built tools. I have a tool with the Yum. I can do a Yum install. You do Yum install root in the HTTPD. If you just do that, just Apache, you will get an image that's 400 megabytes. If you give it two flags and say just install English, it'll go down to 200 megabytes. Then there's a glibc, which comes with a big bundle library of languages, of all languages, and you can go into that and eliminate all languages but English, and you get it down to 100 megabytes. But that's a Apache server without the kernel and stuff. So that's about starting to get about as small as possible. You can get, theoretically, you can get smaller, but when you're managing these, I don't know, it's probably not a good, usually this takes on a full network, like 10 seconds. But I don't know. The last time I tried this, MIT kicked me off, so they might not like me.
On a Debian system, I can't remember the name, I think it might have been a Dev Bootstrap, will generate a file tree which is not only a Debian system, and I seem to recall it was smaller than that.
Yeah, and then you can do there's a BusyBox one of these that's very, very small. The question that, if you get too small, now I go in to do any type of debugging, and I don't have, core utilities, I don't have LS.
Sure.
Like, okay, so the thing is, once you've got it on your box, once you have sure on the box, you're not sucking it down again.
Right.
So it's just the one time. You get the one time down.
You just showed this system D starting up a container when there was traffic on port 80. Is there any kind of way that you shut down a container if there's no activity?
I work a lot with the OpenShift guys, and they're. Everybody here know what OpenShift is? A couple of people know what OpenShift is. If you go to OpenShift.com right now, you can get an account, and you can have a shell on the internet, full of, and you can basically start to build applications for free. Okay, so we've had OpenShift out to PaaS server, so platform as a service. It's been out for, I think, about 3 or 4 years. We actually, I don't know what the current numbers are, but it's in the hundreds of thousands of users. Okay, and all these people are using it for free. It's actually running on EC2. It's a bunch of VMs running hundreds of thousands of these containerized environments. I lost your question.
So shutting down.
Shutting down, yes. Okay. So, so one of the things here is they don't want, if you have 150,000 or 200,000, 300 or whatever thousand users on it, each one of them are building little Apache web servers that they're going to run their little CPI or PHP or more powerful menus for restaurants. You really want to kill these things when they're not running. Right? So what OpenShift has done is they've actually built up algorithms that watch IP tables for packet throughput, and over a certain period of time, if you don't have packets coming into your containerized process, they will kill it. So systemd in RHEL 7 has the ability to say, I'm going to run this process for so long, but it's really not, it doesn't have the heuristics of knowing whether or not it's killing it. So systemd has the ability to auto start applications and to have them time out. So what we're looking at is using OpenShift's technology that's been watching these processes and figuring out whether or not they're having any network traffic and then killing them. So potentially we'll pull that into a Docker type environment that allow you optionally to say, if this thing is not getting any packets for 10 seconds, then you kill it. But it's a hot problem, right? If you're running a database in there that's doing tons and tons of number crunching, you really don't want to kill it because they're going to go network traffic. So, So anyways, that failed miserably, and you know, just never do a demo, or at least a demo that relies on networking at the college that doesn't want to hand out this. So anyways, that gives you some idea of what Docker is. And you know, as I said, we're really hot on it. It's almost as big a change to the computing industry as VMs were, say, 5, 10 years ago. So if you remember Linux before, when Zen was first coming out 6, 7, 8 years ago, this is another, I think, a leap in technology that is going to quickly become important. So,
thank you, Dan.
Yeah.